Okay, so we have seen how using Laplace transforms we can solve for a fairly broad class of differential equations in a very clever and elegant systematic way, right? So typically these kind of differential equations had some forcing term on the right hand side. We had like a sine of omega t or cosine omega t, sometimes a square wave may be in there. But there are also certain kinds of forcing terms which are very impulsive in nature. They operate for a very, very tiny amount of time and they have a certain impulsive effect associated with them, and these two are of great importance in physical applications, right? So these kinds of scenarios are modeled with the help of what is called a Dirac delta function. So the subject of this lecture is to discuss the Dirac delta function and look at some of its properties. So the Dirac delta function is technically speaking not quite a function. It's thought of more like a generalized, it's a distribution, right? It's thought of more like a distribution, or sometimes it's called a generalized function. So our approach here is to learn how to work with it. It's something that perhaps what we have already seen chiefly in the context of electrodynamics, right? So but it's a topic which is somewhat confusing until we have learned to use it with some practice. It's something that we can work with and it's somewhat subtle. So let's look at intuitively what a Dirac delta function is and more importantly what it does. So the way our approach will be to learn to work with the Dirac delta function. So it's useful to start with a Gaussian function, right? So this is something that we are all familiar with. So f of x is equal to 1 over square root of 2 pi sigma e to the minus x squared divided by 2 sigma squared. And let's plot this function. If I plot this function, I have this parameter sigma. And so if I plot it, I start with, let's say I start with some very high value of sigma. So I find that this function is, well spread out and its peak is small, and it spans over a large region where it in the scale that we are looking at, it has a significant value, right? But as I keep on decreasing sigma, right, so here I'm going to decrease sigma, so then you will see that the peak goes higher and higher and higher, and its width begins to shrink. So, and in fact, when I reduce sigma to a very small value, right, its peak has become very large and its width is very tiny, right? So in fact, sigma itself is a measure of its width, right? So as you might know from a discussion of Gaussian functions. But what is interesting is what happens to this function as you keep on shrinking it further and further and further. You take the limit of sigma going to zero, right? So then this function becomes a weird object. It's what is called a Dirac delta function, right? So one thing which is very interesting here is no matter what value of sigma you choose, we have defined our function in such a way that the area under the curve, or this integral, minus infinity to plus infinity, this function dx, is always unity, right? So what whatever area is in there is unity. It may be squished into a very, very tiny region, or it may be spread out over a broader region, but the total area is the same. So even when you take this the limit of sigma becoming very small, going to zero, even then it's still supposed to admit an area of unity. And so the way the function manages to do this is by becoming infinity at exactly x equal to 0, but it is 0 everywhere else. It's a weird kind of function. So that's why mathematicians rather don't call it a function, because it takes a value of infinity at one point and it is 0 everywhere else. But the key point is that the area under this curve is also guaranteed to be unity. And so there are two key properties which are of vital importance, right? So both of these are integral properties. One is like what we just said, if you find the area under this curve, you know, we call this function as delta of x minus a, right? So physicists loosely call it, you know, a function, but it's, you know, these ideas go back to Dirac, and so it's called the Dirac delta function. And minus infinity to plus infinity, if you integrate this function, you know, in the entire span, so minus infinity to plus infinity, you get unity. So, and this is true, in fact, if you take even a tiny, you know, range, as long as the point A is also included, you could go from minus 1 to plus 1, for example, or, you know, even a very, very small region, as long as the point x equal to A is included in this case, right? So, we started with a discussion of this Gaussian being peaked about the origin, but this could be made to peak around any point A. So, right, so you have a, this is the idea of a delta function, which has infinity at one point and zero everywhere else, and which integrates to one. Also, if you take any function g of x and multiply by this function delta of x minus a and integrate, so this will pick out for you the value of this function at precisely that point, and it basically kills all the information about this function everywhere else, but it will give you just the information about just one point. So you can also think of the delta function as, you know, something which when integrated out will extract for you the value of a function at just one point, right? So this is a very useful you know, way of constructing a function, right? It has applications, or, you know, this method of, you know, you can think of a function being made up of values at every point. So you can think of, you know, putting a delta function at any given point and pulling out the information, and then you can have a train of such delta functions and pull out values at various points and so on, right? So these are techniques which we will probably return to at a later time. So the key point here is that, you know, a Dirac delta function has these properties. These are fundamental properties, and operationally the best thing to do with a Dirac delta function is to integrate it, right? So whenever you have a Dirac delta function in any application, always look for a way to integrate it out or multiply with some function and integrate it out so that you can use these properties. That's the, you know, safest way to treat a delta function is to integrate it, right? So we built up this Dirac delta function using a sequence of Gaussian functions, but there are many different ways of building the Dirac delta function, and they all give you the same, right? For example, we could have instead of having you know, Gaussians, we could have had rectangles whose width keeps on squishing but whose height increases, you know, such that the product of the width times the height is always unity, right? So that the area is maintained, and then you can imagine keeping on squishing such that you take the limit, and that's the delta function. That's also the same delta function. Or you could have started with a triangle, right, or some other shape which you can squish such that the area is held a constant. So let's look at just one another example of you know, a sequence of functions which gives you a you know, the same Dirac delta function. So let's look at a function like this, f of x is equal to n times e to the minus nx, which is defined for x greater than 0, but it is 0 for x less than 0. This also will go to the Dirac delta function as you make n very large. So let's plot it out. So if I have n, if n is a very small value, then it's a, you know, this function, of course, it's exponentially decaying, but it's you know, it has a large span all the way up to 2, it has not really vanished. But as you increase n, you see that its peak becomes larger and larger, and for all practical purposes it's 0 for, you know, larger values of x. You know, x equal to 1, already you see that hardly it has any representation, and then you see that as you increase n further and further and further, its value at x equal to 0 is becoming larger and larger, and in the limit n going to infinity, you know, one can show that this function also becomes the Dirac delta function, meaning that it's going to be infinite at x equal to 0 and 0 everywhere else, right? So this is just to illustrate that, you know, one can think of the Dirac delta function in many different ways. There are ways, sometimes it's more convenient to use a different representation of the Dirac delta function when we are working with, you know, doing algebra of which involves Dirac delta functions. Often we may have to work with a sequence, you know, find out the limit and then take the appropriate limit and calculate certain properties and so on. So, but in this discussion, let's look at how one can find the Laplace transform of the Dirac delta function, right? So, where we directly exploit these key properties. There are other properties which we should discuss, but perhaps in a later discussion. But here we will try and exploit just these integral properties to work out the Laplace transform of the Dirac delta function, and we'll make use of that to solve certain differential equations. So let's see, it's straightforward enough. Suppose you have an impulse function, right? So you oftentimes you think of turning on some voltage, for example, in some electrical circuit, or you're applying a force which operates for an infinitesimally small amount of time. It provides an impulse and then it's gone, right? So that is modeled with the help of a Dirac delta function. So if I take the Laplace transform of delta of t minus t naught, it's operating at the Dirac delta function is localized at t naught. So I have to do integral 0 to infinity delta of t minus t naught e to the minus st dt. And then this is something we know how to do, right? This is the property of the Dirac delta function, is if you multiply, by any function, it's going to pick out the value of the function at that point, provided that t naught is greater than 0. It's within this integral, right? So the limits must cover this point, otherwise it will be 0, right? So we get e to the minus st naught. So by the way, this is a property which we can in fact derive, right? So you can start with some function g of x, and then in place of delta of x minus a, you can plug in this value, this function, do the integral and then take the limit, and then you can show that indeed this property holds, right? So but for our purposes, we'll just accept this as a property, right? And maybe that can be homework. You can explicitly check that this holds, and this will hold, regardless of which sequence of functions that becomes the Dirac delta function you use, whether you use triangles, rectangles, or if you use these exponential curves, or if you use Gaussians, it doesn't matter. Okay, so the main message here is the Laplace transform of this Dirac delta function, delta of t minus t naught, is simply e to the minus s t naught. Right? So it's an exponential decay in this s. So this holds only if t naught is greater than 0. Now let's look at what happens if this were the external force that applies to some harmonic oscillator like problem, let's say. So suppose we consider the undamped harmonic oscillator d squared x by dt squared plus omega squared x, and you apply this impulsive external force at some time t naught, which is greater than 0, right? And we are also given the initial conditions, it's at rest at time t equal to 0, right? So there is no speed associated with it. So we take the Laplace transform throughout, and we know that the Laplace transform of the second order derivative is given by s squared times x of s minus s times x of 0 minus dx by dt at time t equal to 0. Both the last two terms are 0 because of the initial conditions here. So we simply get s squared x of x. And so the Laplace transform gives us an algebraic equation in this x of s. So I have s squared x of s plus omega squared x of s is equal to Laplace transform of, so this should be a delta function. So I should say delta. So I have a delta function on the right hand side. So this is something that I can immediately solve for, and I have the answer x of s is e to the minus st naught divided by s squared plus omega squared, right? So this is a function for which I know how to compute the inverse Laplace transform. So we have seen that, if you have a factor like e to the minus st naught, it's like doing a shift in time domain, right? So it gives us this theta t naught of t, and this function itself is 1 over omega inverse Laplace transform 1 over s squared plus omega squared, is just simply 1 over omega times sine of, because of the shift involved, we have omega of t minus t naught, and which can be written more explicitly as x of t is 0 if t is less than t naught, and it's 1 over omega times sine of omega times t minus t naught if t is greater than t naught, right? So it's as if basically your system is at rest, there's nothing happening to it. Of course, it's physically reasonable that x of t will remain 0 all the way up to t naught. When there is this impulse, and the moment this impulse has acted and stopped, it's going to, you know, get these oscillations in play and they will last, right? That's what is going on, right? So physically it's very reasonable what is given by this solution. So before we end, we'll finally look at just one more, you know, topic, which is that the Dirac delta function, so the Fourier transform of the Dirac delta function is also useful. Just like we looked at the Laplace transform of the Dirac delta function, it's also useful to study the Fourier transform of the Dirac delta function. It finds application in all kinds of contexts. So if you do the Fourier transform, so in our convention, we have a 1 over 2 pi times integral minus infinity to plus infinity delta of x minus a times e to the minus I alpha x dx, right? So we have seen that this is supposed to pick out just the value of this function e to the minus I alpha x at x equal to a. So we simply get 1 over 2 pi times e to the minus I alpha a. Now, formally, we can use this, since this is the Fourier transform of the function delta of x minus a. So delta of x minus a is the inverse Fourier transform of this function 1 over 2 pi times e to the minus alpha a. So formally, we have this inverse Fourier transform relation. So delta of x minus a must be equal to 1 over 2 pi integral minus infinity to plus infinity e to the I, you know, e to the I alpha times x minus a, right? So we have this, one of these factors comes from just doing the inverse Fourier transform, and the other is this function itself. But you see that this integral on the right hand side is not a convergent integral, right? So it's in fact just a formal representation, but it's often a very useful representation, right? So in place of delta of x minus a, one can just put in this integral, and then many simplifications may arise, depending upon the context. So the way to think about this is, you should replace these limits minus infinity to plus infinity. Instead of that, you put in some minus n to plus n, and think of taking n to be larger and larger, right? So you'll then construct a sequence of functions which are more and more sharply picked about x equal to a, and such that their area under the curve is always taken to be unity, right? So if you think of it in that way, then it is similar to what we had earlier, right? We had a sequence of Gaussian, sequence of triangles or rectangles or exponentially falling functions, or something like this. They're all completely equivalent ways of constructing the the final object in the limit is the same. So this is a formal representation, because as such it does not converge, but we know what it means. So the delta of x minus a has this formal integral representation, right, which came out of taking the Fourier transform and the inverse Fourier transform of the Dirac delta function. Okay, that's all for this lecture. There are more properties of Dirac delta function which we will look at later on, but that's all for this lecture. Thank you.